Thank you for joining us this evening. I'm Vic Amar. I'm the Dean of the College of Law here at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And in commemoration of the sesquicentennial, that's the 150th anniversary of President Lincoln's death, and then 2 years later of the founding of the University of Illinois, one of the original land-grant institutions that Lincoln's signature on the Morrill Land Act facilitated, the College of Law presents the new Lincoln Lectures, What Abraham Lincoln Means to the 21st Century. Now, this is a series of talks, of lectures, in which luminaries in various fields relating to law, government, history, and the like reflect on President Lincoln's legacy and its continuing relevance, both in people's individual lives and also the life of the nation 150 years after his passing. Tonight, we are distinctively honored to host Norman J. Ornstein, resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute, which is maybe the most well-known think tank in Washington, D.C. There are lots of impressive and interesting things about Norm that I could mention, such as the fact that he graduated from the University of Minnesota at age 18. He graduated from high school at age 14. You can ask him about that over dinner. Or that he is the longtime friend of Al Franken. I'm sure I'd like to get some Al Franken stories out of him. But for our purposes this evening, I note simply that he is, I think it's fair to say, the country's preeminent scholar of congressional institutions and practices. Norm is a contributing editor and columnist for the National Journal and the Atlantic, and is an election eve analyst for BBC News. He served as co-director of the AEI Brookings Election Reform Project and participates in AEI's Election Watch series. He led a working group of scholars and practitioners that helped shape the law known as McCain-Feingold. Everyone in this room should have heard of that, that reformed, or at least sought to reform, the campaign financing system. He was elected as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the most august honorary institution for people outside the hard sciences, in 2004. His many books include The Permanent Campaign and Its Future in 2000, The Broken Branch, How Congress is Failing America and How to Get It Back on Track with Thomas E. Mann in 2006, a book named by the Washington Post as one of the best of the year and called a classic by The Economist. And most recently, the New York Times bestseller titled, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, How the American Constitutional System Collided with the New Politics of Extremism, also authored with Tom Mann, published in 2012. I had the pleasure of participating in a project in which Norm was taking the lead last year concerning the decision made by the Republican leadership in the Senate to decline to process Merrick Garland's nomination to the Supreme Court. And even though it was a relatively short document that Norm produced, it displayed all the characteristics that make him so effective and so credible. It was careful, it was balanced, it was attentive to nuances in constitutional structure, history, and practice. It was nonpartisan in its big picture analysis, and it was very usable in its political and policy implications. I'm very much looking forward to hearing Norm's remarks tonight relating both to Mr. Lincoln's times and also to our own. Recall, of course, that Mr. Lincoln not only had to work with a complicated Congress when he was president, but he himself was a member of the U.S. House of Representatives for the 7th District in Illinois in the late 1840s. Indeed, that House service was his last elective position prior to becoming president, and really his only federal elective experience at all. I must admit candidly that I have a great deal of difficulty these days just making sense, literally, just navigating happenings in D.C. to the point where I try to go a few days at a time without looking at headlines, as risky as that may be. It's not just that the rules have changed. They change in the law all the time. We're used to that as lawyers. I just don't know that there are rules anymore. So that's what's so perplexing and in some ways scary to some of us. But if anyone can identify some useful analytic and comparative frameworks to consider, its Norm. So with that, let me turn the stage over to him.
Thank Thanks so much, Vic. I'll just give you a couple of other little twists to introduce myself. One of the things that I'm doing now, it's probably the most fun thing that I'm doing, is I'm a consultant for the HBO series Veep. The new season starts, actually, I think this coming weekend, and it is, I can tell you, going to be a terrific season, but it's been a struggle because this is fantastic satire, and satire is where you take reality and then you push it to the point of absurdity. And when you have to start at the point of absurdity, there have been multiple times where the writers would come up with a scene and then it would happen and we'd have to change it. So the other thing that I'll mention, since Vic noted my relationship with Al Franken, there's a book I would recommend to you very highly. It's a book that actually now is over 15 years old. It's called Why Not Me? And Al wrote it as a tale of how he became president in the year 2000, beating Al Gore in the primaries and then going on to win. And I recommend it for a couple of reasons. One is it's remarkably prescient because the story of Al Franken becoming president is the story of a bombastic, lying, law-breaking populist who rides to victory on the basis of attacking high ATM fees. And in that book, I am his campaign manager, regularly writing memos saying, you can't do that. Really, you're not allowed to do that. And he would go ahead and do it. But we were also a small team of people that kind of worked out the scenarios, prescient in other ways. We picked, probably 6 months before Al Gore did, Joe Lieberman for his running mate, because we wanted a balanced ticket, a Reformed Jew and an Orthodox Jew. we then picked an all-Jewish cabinet after he won. My contribution was Ralph Lauren as Secretary of the Interior. And in the end, in the book, we'll see how prescient this is. He becomes president, I become his chief of staff. He ends up impeached and removed from office, and I go to jail. So we'll see how everything goes. I want to apologize just a little bit in advance. I usually don't do this, but I took this lecture seriously and I wrote it out, so I'm actually going to sort of read it. I'm delighted to be doing this on the sesquicentennial. And as I was telling some of the law school people before we started, the last time I did a sesquicentennial event was at the University of Rochester. And I started back then, it was George W. Bush was president. And I told them that President Bush would have been there, but when he tried to pronounce sesquicentennial, he ended up seriously injuring himself. So in 2011, I wrote a piece for Foreign Policy magazine, which was on the 112th Congress, which the editors very cleverly titled Worst Period Congress Period Ever Period. And that title got the article a lot of attention and a lot of criticism, most of which was along these lines. Oh, come on, really? The worst Congress ever? What about the period leading up to the Civil War? And my response was, of course, you're right. Isn't it comforting to be compared to the period right before the Civil War? Now, that was then, 6 years ago, and the foreign policy article preceded the book that Vic talked about on the state of American politics that I did with Tom Mann, came out in 2012, and I gave it the title, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, How the American Constitutional System Collided with the New Politics of Extremism. And we updated the book with a new version last year, altering the title to be It's Even Worse Than It Was. And people have asked me what the next one would be, and I've said, run for your lives, perhaps. But actually, I will tell you that I am just in the final stages of a new book with Tom Mann and E.J. Dionne, with the title, I'm pretty sure, going to be One Nation After Trump, A Guide for the Perplexed, the Disillusioned, the Desperate, and the Not Yet Deported. And that will be out in September. So, It's Even Worse Than It Looks became a New York Times bestseller, as Vic said, on the strength, really, of another even more provocative title, which was given by Carlos Lozada, who was the editor of the Washington Post's Outlook section, We wrote an excerpt on the eve of the book's publication, and he titled it, "Let's Just Say It, The Republicans Are the Problem." That excerpt included the following description of the Republican Party at the time, and I quote, "An insurgent outlier, ideologically extreme, contemptuous of the inherited social and economic policy regime, scornful of compromise, unpersuaded by conventional understanding of facts, evidence, and science, and dismissive of the legitimacy of its political opposition." Now, that description came years before Donald Trump emerged as a presidential candidate, much less as the standard bearer of the Republican Party, much less as the 45th president of the United States, bringing us a new national anthem, "We Shall Overcome," a new reality series, "Dancing with the Czars." But with the possible exception of the term ideologically extreme, after all, you have to have a form of coherent belief system to have the term ideology applied to you, it resonates in spades now, I believe, for the party and the president. So a question I wanted to ask is, what is the contemporary Republican Party? Is it a conservative party or a radical one? Is it acting in ways that are typical or within the normal boundaries of behavior in a typically rowdy and contentious political system? And the title, "It's Even Worse Than It Looks," was very deliberately chosen because the political system never looks good. It is always contentious and difficult. That's the nature of a democratic small d political system. But we were in a situation where it was even worse. And in the age of Trump, can it still merit the title Party of Lincoln? That's the question that I want to explore in the first part of this lecture. For many decades, of course, the two parties have claimed an annual day, it's usually in February or March, to celebrate their connections to venerated presidents and, more important, to raise funds for local party organizations at a dinner. For the Democrats, the Jefferson-Jackson Day dinner has in recent years been riven with controversy over both presidents. Jefferson for owning slaves, Jackson for slaughtering Native Americans, among other reasons. Lincoln Day hasn't had the same backlash among active Republicans for an obvious reason. Abraham Lincoln had his controversies, suspending habeas corpus at the top of the list, but he's not had any significant revisionist scholarship or politically correct backlash. He's almost universally regarded as a great man and a great president. Now, there is a backlash against the enthusiastic embrace of the great president by his party, just one coming from non-Republicans and Republicans outside the political establishment. But let's start with a capsule history. For the first part of his political career, before there was a Republican Party, Abraham Lincoln was a Whig, a loyal one. But that party was pretty much decimated with its landslide defeat in 1852. There was a competition to fill the vacuum in the aftermath with a new contender, the Know-Nothings, also known as the Native American Party and just the American Party. It was created as a backlash against the wave of Irish and German immigration and against Catholicism. The party used the slogan, quote, "Americans only shall govern America," a less elegant version of "America First" or "Make America Great Again." And they amassed an ardent public following. The Know-Nothings believed that immigration and the immigrants flooding in were creating a surplus of labor, lowering factory wages. The party's appeal was very strong in 1854 when it won a series of elections in cities and states, in the North especially. Their popularity did not impress Abraham Lincoln. He was repelled by their nativism, and he showed it in private correspondence, including in a famous letter in August of 1855, where he wrote, "I am not a know-nothing, that is certain. How could I be? How can anyone who abhors the oppression of Negroes be in favor of degrading classes of white people? Our progress in degeneracy appears to me to be pretty rapid. As a nation, we began by declaring that all men are created equal. We now practically read it, all men are created equal except Negroes. When the Know-Nothings get control, it will read, all men are created equal except Negroes and foreigners and Catholics. When it comes to that, I should prefer emigrating to some country where they make no pretense of loving liberty. To Russia, for instance, where despotism can be taken pure and without the base alloy of hypocrisy." Now, fortunately, the American Party faltered in the presidential election in 1856, which had actually a former Whig president, Millard Fillmore, heading its ticket. And when Democrat James Buchanan won, the American Party split between pro- and anti-slavery factions, and it began to fade away. And the Republican Party was born to be the antidote to the Democratic Party and to Stephen Douglas and his notion of allowing slavery to be optional in non-Southern territories. Lincoln expressed this directly in 1859 in speech notes for an address in Columbus, Ohio. Quote, "The Republican cause cannot live by Douglas's positions." That's capital R. "His position, whether for or against a slave code, for or against Lecompton, leads inevitably to the nationalizing and perpetuity of slavery, and the Republican Party cause cannot live by it." Now, Lincoln was both a moderate and a conservative, moderate in tone and a believer in civil discourse, and powerful reason as the core of debate and deliberation, and conservative in the deeper sense of conserving the values of the framers and the sanctity of the Union. His conservatism did not keep him from attacking the Constitution's vision of slavery, including its manifestations in the Fugitive Slave Law, or attacking the Supreme Court's interpretation of it in Dred Scott, or from pivoting from a celebration of the Constitution to a deeper appreciation for the values embedded in the Declaration of Independence. And in the Columbus speech itself, the one for which I read the notes, Lincoln said this, "The chief and real reason of the, or purpose of the Republican Party is eminently conservative. It proposes nothing save and except to restore this government to its original tone in regard to this element of slavery, and there to maintain it, looking for no further change in reference to it than that which the original framers of the government themselves expected and looked forward to." And in his Cooper Union speech in 1860, Lincoln talked about the framers and what today we would call originalism, which is pretty relevant this week. He said, "I do not mean to say we are bound to follow implicitly in whatever our fathers did. To do so would be to discard all the lights of current experience, to reject all progress, all improvement. What I do say is that if we would supplant the opinions and policy of our fathers in any case, we should do so upon evidence so conclusive and argument so clear that even their great authority, fairly considered and weighed, cannot stand, and most surely not in a case whereof we ourselves declare they understood the question better than we." Kind of talking about a living constitution. So let me cut to the chase. The party of Lincoln was formed in a crucible of revulsion against crude nativism and religious bigotry, against crude racism and evil slavery. The party of Lincoln believed in equality, in the natural rights of all as expressed in the Declaration of Independence, to which he gave primacy, and in the moral force of that principle, and in the importance of duty to the principles of the founding and the sanctity of the nation, the whole Union, not just part of it, binding us all together. And the party of Lincoln also believed in important ways in a living constitution, in taking the fundamental principles of the founding and applying them as best as possible to contemporary challenges and new mores. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole arc of history from the time of Lincoln's assassination to the present day, except to say that across a century of many ups and downs, there were plenty of examples of a Republican Party devoted to those principles. It was true when Wendell Willkie and Thomas Dewey got pro-civil rights planks inserted into the Republican platform when they each ran for president in the 1940s. And nowhere was it more true than in the 1950s and 1960s when Republican heroes like Bill McCulloch of Ohio, Everett Dirksen from Peoria, Mac Mathias from Maryland, and many others rescued the 1957 Civil Rights Act, the 1964 Act, and the 1965 Voting Rights Act from Southern Democrats who opposed them all. Of course, the seeds for change in both parties were there in the 1964 Act. Barry Goldwater and then Texas Senate candidate George H.W. Bush both opposed it, showing how the tectonic plates were shifting for the parties on the race issue. Goldwater's candidacy began the remarkable change in the regional realignments of American politics, with the South moving from its long period of Democratic Party hegemony toward the new world of Republican dominance, accelerated further by Nixon's Southern strategy in 1968. The opportunity for the Republican Party to capture the allegiance of a healthy share of African American votes, which was there for the taking in the Eisenhower era, disappeared. And catchphrases and dog whistles like law and order and welfare queen, not lost on black voters, further cemented the racial partisan divide. But a set of votes against civil rights measures and social welfare benefits, including affirmative action, along with hard-nosed political strategies that all moved 90% or more of African American voters to the Democratic camp, was not accompanied for a long time by a similar approach to other minority groups or on immigration issues. Conservative social policy positions, a tough stance on Vietnam and Cuba, and a focus on entrepreneurship attracted many Asian Americans to the GOP. In fact, Asian Americans in 1992, according to the first major surveys looking at their voting patterns, supported George H.W. Bush over Bill Clinton by 55% to 31%. They were twice as likely to describe themselves as conservative than as liberal. And on immigration, Republicans were for expanding immigration and leaders on comprehensive and compassionate immigration reform. One of the major ones, my friend and one of my great heroes, Alan Simpson. Latinos were less attracted to Republicans, but the GOP still managed to get a healthy 40% in 1992. When George W. Bush ran in 2000 and again in 2004, he attracted enough Hispanic support that it was easy to imagine a new era emerging for the GOP, making it highly competitive with Democrats for Hispanic voters as they increased in size and proportion in the electorate. But for both minority groups, the opportunity began to slip away after that, in part excited by the changes represented by Barack Obama, but also increasingly turned off by the more strident rhetoric of a more conservative and radicalizing Republican Party. Latinos and Asian Americans moved more and more into the Democratic camp. When Barack Obama won Asian Americans by a 2-to-1 margin in 2008, Republicans were confident that it was a one-off, that the appeal to conservative economics and small business and to social policy, combined with the fact that immigration was not a top three issue for the Asian American community, would swing them back to GOP ranks. In fact, they became even more tied to Democrats. If immigration was not the top issue for them, it was still symbolic, the sense of whether they were wanted and respected as minorities. And as my longtime colleague Henry Olson has pointed out, for a group where Christians make up only a minority, the Republican overt appeal to Christian conservatives and rhetoric that emphasized the Christian tradition or the Judeo-Christian tradition in America leaves the rest out. My colleague Charles Murray put it more colorfully. Asian Americans don't feel inclined to support, as he put it, a party of Bible-thumping, anti-gay, anti-abortion creationists. At the same time, the appeal that George W. Bush had to Latinos was fading fast by 2008, and it got worse in 2012. The Republican defeat that year led to RNC Chairman Reince Priebus's notorious party autopsy, a strange word to use when you're trying to revive a party, and its strong appeal to Republicans to broaden their appeal to minorities, starting with the immigration issue, a plea that, as we know, fell on deaf ears. Now, all that preceded Trump, and now we have a Republican Party that is far closer to the know-nothings, to the American Party, call it the Make America Great Again Party, than it is to the party Lincoln helped found. Nativist, antagonistic to all immigrants, an overt appeal by the president's closest advisors to change even legal immigration to make the country more like us, anti-Muslim in rhetoric and in action, supporting the party's avid pursuit of aggressive moves to suppress minority votes via restrictive voter laws, in the aftermath of a Republican-led Supreme Court gutting the landmark Voting Rights Act, referring to Mexican rapists, attacking a judge for having a Mexican heritage, ignoring white supremacist murders of minorities while emphasizing any attacks by minorities on others, all of which led former Bush speechwriter and conservative Michael Gerson to write, quote, "The party of Lincoln is dying." He added, "Is Trump himself a racist? Who the bloody hell cares? There is no difference in public influence between a politician who is a racist and one who appeals to racist sentiments with racist arguments. The harm to the country measured in division and fear is the same, whatever the inner workings of Trump's heart, unquote. Now, in Lincoln's time, the country was divided about race, religion, immigration, region. Economic insecurity heightened the divisions, including over slavery. Abraham Lincoln set as his supreme goal surmounting those divisions, creating a lasting union, appealing to the best in humanity, celebrating the moral force of the equality highlighted in the Declaration of Independence. In our time, the country is divided about race, religion, immigration, region, and increasingly, economic inequality. Where is the Lincoln to help us surmount those divisions? Not in the White House, not in the Congress, only in a few brave voices in the GOP wilderness. Now, let me add a few reflections on Lincoln as president, some of which Vic heralded, and which themselves will be interesting benchmarks to use to evaluate our current president. Lincoln, of course, was a controversial choice by the Republican Party in 1860, leaving his rivals for the nomination believing that the best man, William Seward, had lost to an inferior. As many historians, Doris Kearns Goodwin among them, have pointed out, nearly all of his cabinet, along with members of Congress, changed their minds. He won them over with his attention to detail, passion, thoughtfulness, toughness, and political skills. As Seward himself put it, he is the best of us. And he often said, he is the best and wisest man I have ever known. Lincoln was not ego-driven. John Bigelow, who had not been a particular fan of his, was appointed by him to be consul general in Paris. And Bigelow had one meeting with the president where the discussion with a number of others was mostly about operations in the field. And Bigelow said afterwards, quote, what did impress me was what I can only describe as a certain lack of sovereignty. He seemed to me, nor was it in the least strange that he did, like a man utterly unconscious of the space which the President of the United States occupied that day in the history of the human race and of the vast power for the exercise of which he had become personally responsible. And the journalist Alan Thorndike Ross wrote, wielding the power of a king, he retained the modesty of a commoner. At the same time, Lincoln treated his adversaries and rivals with respect and equanimity. Seward, as Secretary of State, antagonistically challenged the new president over his war conduct and powers in an in-your-face way. Lincoln dealt with him so respectfully and delicately that they became fast friends and intimates. As the University of Virginia historian William Lee Miller put it, he did not mark down the names of those who had supported him or nurse grudges or had not supported him or nurse grudges or hold resentments or retaliate against enemies. Indeed, he tried not to have enemies. Lincoln's style of governance, both in rhetoric and action, was built around reason and driven by intellect. The historian James Randall wrote, Lincoln's leadership was intellectual, but at the same time stirring, restrained, but with the rallying power of a bugle. Reason and sentiment with Lincoln were in balance. Both, he knew, were requisite to a wholesome personality. He could touch the chords of human feeling, but never with a tearful appeal. There was no play-acting in his emotional passages. Miller noted that in a letter to a Louisiana Unionist in 1862, Lincoln wrote, I shall do nothing in malice. What I deal with is too vast for malicious dealing. What about Congress? Members of Congress, confronting a former colleague who had only that one term in the House, were not particularly impressed by or enthusiastically about the new president. But he found ways both to gain their respect and to work with them, or at times to win over their deep objections. Team of Rivals and that movie Lincoln showed that he could play tough and at times stretch the boundaries of political wheeling and dealing. He also managed to avoid Congress's roadblocks by doing things like calling for troops, instituting a blockade, and suspending habeas corpus when Congress was out of session. But as the historian William Giepnap noted, Lincoln's relationship with the legislative branch, while at times strained, never broke down completely, And in particular, they were better than under either his predecessor, James Buchanan, or his successor, Andrew Johnson. The more harmonious relationship reflected in part the fact that Lincoln was much more tactful and flexible in his approach. But his adeptness in dealing with Congress was built on his personal skills of close observation and deep knowledge of substance and the main arguments against his own positions. In a discussion with the Speaker of the House, Schuyler Colfax, he talked about the idiosyncrasies and individual characteristics of congressional giants like Thaddeus Stevens, Charles Sumner, and Henry Wilson with remarkable insight, and then noted, ruminating, that from an early age, every one of his own idiosyncrasies had been to habitually study the opposite side of every issue, every law case, every political issue more deeply than his own side, meaning he was never surprised by the case made by his opponents and always ready to counter it. And of course, he built on that strength to use his own remarkable writing skills and rhetorical ability to persuade and move people, both the broader public and politicians. Every president in some ways is judged against an unfair template forged by the greatest among them. Who can measure up? Presidents are judged by the long sweep of history, by whether they faced major crises and handled them well, by how they wore the mantle of leadership, by how they led, inspired, and moved the American people, by their lasting accomplishments, by their character, honesty, and integrity, by whether they lifted the country up to appeal to its better angels or dragged it down by crass appeals to the darker side. We are barely 2 months into Donald Trump's presidential term, but he has already established himself as the anti-Lincoln. Even more than Lincoln, he came to the office without deep experience in governance. Indeed, as the first president ever to have none. But while Lincoln surrounded himself with people with deep experience, including those who were his deepest rivals, Trump surrounded himself with people with little or no experience in the White House or the executive branch, and for both his White House staff and advisors, weeded out those who had criticized him during the campaign, leaving him with a small and distorted recruitment pool. At the same time, he has showed no interest in the mechanics or processes of government, failing so far to even nominate people to 95% of the key positions in his administration. Trump, from the day he won the election and the day he was sworn into the office, showed no change in character, no understanding of the weight of responsibility in the office, no interest in binding national wounds after an era of tribalism and a bitter campaign. He held political rallies even after he had won and after his inauguration, continued to ridicule his opponents after the election, including smiling benignly as his supporters chanted, "Lock her up." He used the crude communication of Twitter to promote his divisive, racist, anti-Muslim, and anti-immigrant agenda, and to pursue petty vendettas using highly charged rhetoric and bald-faced lies with no eloquence or depth. Many presidents have seen scandals, both financial corruption and personal peccadilloes. Even Lincoln had it. His Secretary of War, Simon Cameron, had to resign over corruption. But no president started his term with the level of in-your-face personal and family corruption, including direct violations of both emoluments clauses in the Constitution, promoting his business interests by using the leverage of his office, getting benefits from China and other countries. It would be hard to find or imagine another president with less fundamental knowledge of any area of policy, much less any interest in learning about policy or the processes of government, less willing to obtain or appreciate briefings from government professionals, especially from the intelligence community he has viewed with disdain and contempt, who prides himself on getting his information from questionable websites like Breitbart and InfoWars and cable news infotainment programs like Fox and Friends. Few presidents in American history can measure up to Abraham Lincoln, maybe none. Based on 2 months and change in office, few if any presidents in American history can drop down to the level we've seen from Donald Trump. Finally, I just want to reflect on the most troublesome element of the Lincoln presidency and what it means in the contemporary context. Of course, I'm referring to the suspension of habeas corpus, an act that stretched to the limit at least the boundaries of the law and the Constitution. Lincoln knew that and agonized over and he went to great lengths to justify it to himself and to Congress and to others. In his special session message to the House and Senate on July 4, 1861, he offered his reasoning at length as he asked, "Must a government of necessity be too strong for the liberties of its own people or too weak to maintain its own existence?" And he went on to say, "This authority has purposely been exercised very sparingly. Nevertheless, the legality and propriety of what has been done under it are questioned, and the attention of the country has been called to the proposition that one who is sworn to take care that the laws be faithfully executed should not himself violate them." Of course, some consideration was given to the questions of power and propriety before this matter was acted upon. The whole of the laws which were required to be faithfully executed were being resisted and failing of execution in nearly one-third of the states. Must they be allowed to finally fail of execution, even if it had been perfectly clear that by the use of the means necessary to their execution, some single law made in such extreme tenderness of the citizens' liberty that practically it relieves more of the guilty than of the innocent, should to a very limited extent be violated? To state the question more directly, are all the laws but one to go unexecuted and the government itself to go to pieces lest that one be violated? Even in such a case, would not the official oath be broken if the government should be overthrown when it was believed that disregarding the single law would tend to preserve it? Lincoln did not take lightly steps like the suspension of habeas corpus. And his steps were not the only time that war has been used as a rationale for what otherwise would be clear violations of the Constitution. We saw anti-war socialists jailed for inflammatory language at the time of the First World War, and of course we had the internment camps for Japanese Americans in World War II. Both times, the Supreme Court upheld executive decisions to take actions that, especially in the case of the Japanese Americans, we now find repugnant and unimaginable in the present day. Except those actions are not so unimaginable. Take Lincoln's speech to Congress and imagine it being given by Donald Trump. Well, imagine a less eloquent and not so well-reasoned version, probably first field tested on Twitter. Imagine that a series of lone wolf or other small group terrorist attacks inspired by ISIS and just as much by the virulently anti-Muslim rhetoric and travel ban have occurred across the nation. Add the possibility of demonstrations by Black Lives Matters and others after more killings of unarmed minorities following the Justice Department erasing its oversight of rogue police departments. And imagine that some of those demonstrations take a violent turn. Now imagine that Donald Trump, using exactly the same rationale as Lincoln, declares martial law and suspends civil liberties. Because Lincoln was a towering figure and statesman who had genuine fealty to the rule of law, the values of freedom, and the sanctity of the documents of the founding, and perhaps with the benefit of hindsight, I can rest easy that he made sound decisions with an understandable balance. But what happens when a president who is not a statesman, who has authoritarian leanings, who may feel weakened by an investigation of Russian ties closing in, were to use the same or a similar rationale to restrict or even demolish the fundamentals of the system? Now, these fears may be overblown. None of this may well happen. And if such steps were taken, there are encouraging signs. Through the reaction to the first executive orders, the independent judiciary and army of lawyers across the country, a tough media and fearless satirists, and the overall strength of our civil society, that the moves would be fiercely resisted. But this is a great reminder that a constitution, along with a web of laws and rules, are not themselves adequate protection against a threat of tyranny. So I hope I've made my position clear. And with that, I'm very happy to open the floor up to questions or brickbats. And I do want to note that Chief of Staff Reince Priebus, you should always remember that if you take his name and remove the vowels, what you are left with is RNCPRBS. Just keep that in mind. You'll never be able to look at him again without thinking. There are microphones up here. If you can come up and if you would identify yourself.
I'm Bob Wallace, one of the faculty members here.
Yeah.
The Republicans in Congress, where are they? Why are they absent? Why don't they see these things?
That's a very good question. Where are the Republicans in Congress? You know, when you, and I'll get, reflect back on the last comment that I made. You can create a constitution and it can be a fabulous constitution. And always keep in mind that the Soviet Union had a terrific constitution. You look at it and say, boy, this would be, you know, a wonderful society. And you can create these laws, but the norms are what matter. And that starts with Congress as an independent branch, as a check and balance. We've become so tribal that it's just not working. And, you know, I was struck in particular by a comment made by Senator John Thune of South Dakota in January, which was, well, we know he's going to say stupid and crazy things, but if we just send him legislation and he passes it, that'll be just fine. And I think what we have here for an awful lot of people in Congress is a kind of devil's bargain at one level. It is, we'll give him a pass on the kleptocracy. We're going to sort of close our eyes to what might be happening with Russia until we can't anymore. We'll let him have the people that he wants, even if some of them make us cringe, as long as we know he's going to sign whatever we send him, and he doesn't have much of an agenda. You know, it'll be our agenda. That's a part of it. The second part of it is this, and I haven't talked about some of the larger dynamics of the political system. And the degree to which we have become tribal at all levels. But let me put it this way. You know, we first started to measure presidential approval in a more systematic way when Dwight Eisenhower was president. And if you looked at Eisenhower's approval over his 8 years and divided it by party, you'd have the Democrats here and the Republicans here, and as he moved within the band, which wasn't a very wide one, it moved like that. Now consider where we are. Trump's approval rating on average across a series of polls is somewhere between 35% and 38%. Among Democrats, it's between 5% and 8%. With independents, it's about a third. With Republicans, it's somewhere between 80% and 90%. So all of their constituents, and especially the ones who vote in primaries, the ones who might turn out if there's a challenge to them, are still with Trump. And that constrains the way they look at things. That may change, and he's already dropped about 10 points even among Republicans. But right now, we're not getting what we would hope to get. And what we would hope to get, and that's true for any president with any Congress, and it's true for a president with a Congress made up of his own party members, is some effective oversight. It is trying to make sure that you cannot use the office of the presidency or of cabinet positions for personal gain or for corrupt purposes. It is making sure that policies are implemented effectively. It's giving a serious vetting to the people the president nominates, but not obstructing and yet not letting through people you shouldn't. And to me, one of the worst examples here was when Mitch McConnell pushed through the confirmation vote on the new head of EPA, knowing that a few days later, a judge who had ordered that the private emails of a man who had been the attorney general in Oklahoma, which had been held up and not released for years, were scheduled to be released, and made sure that the confirmation vote occurred before those emails were released. And when they were released, it became crystal clear that he had lied to Congress when he had said, I did nothing that had any official bearing in my private emails. This was a real email scandal, but something that should have been available. And we saw the same thing with the confirmation of Dr. Price, and we're now finding even more information about manipulation of actions in Congress while he was holding stock or buying stock. When you're not getting vetting at that level, that's a problem. And when you're not getting any kind of hearings on actions that are both highly questionable and involve serious national security questions, that's why we have to look at other institutions. And there, as I say, the judiciary really does seem to be measuring up. And for the first time in modern memory, lawyers are not being viewed as the lowlifes in the society, but as people across the board, with law firms, with law schools, and in other places, stepping up to fill a vacuum and to help the most vulnerable among us. But it needs to start with Congress.
Let me follow up on Bob's question. So part of your answer to Bob was there's this tribalism, to use your mm-hmm. term, and that accounts for a much stronger commitment to political party over other factors.
Yeah.
But I'm just wondering, since when and why does party trump everything? It trumps institution if you're in Congress. It trumps policy if you're a poor Appalachian who is willing to take cuts to rural areas just because you believe in this guy. It's not even clear to me it's all about race if you look at the percentage of Latinos who voted for Trump. Certainly not about gender because he got a lot of women. So what accounts for this connection to a political party as your identity?
So it's actually not quite so simple in an odd way. Tribalism, as it operates now, is more a revulsion against the other side than it is an attachment to your own. And we know at the mass level, we have a lot of studies now, that it's negative partisanship that works. And that explains some of the oddities out there. If it were the attachment to your own side, Bernie Sanders would have gotten nowhere. He'd never been a Democrat for a day in his life until he ran for president. After he started to run, his campaign manager said, and he never contradicted him, he only became a Democrat because it was a vehicle to pursue what he wanted to pursue. And the day after he dropped out of the race, he left the Democratic Party. But he had an ardent following. Donald Trump has had as many parties as he's had wives. And said himself several years ago, well, I might run as a Republican because I think, you know, I can tell them anything and they'll believe it. But he was embraced, as were a number of outsiders who'd never been actively involved in the party before. And in both parties now, you've got these major efforts to try and knock the pins out from under the party organization in choosing nominees in the future, open primaries, caucuses, and getting rid of superdelegates and the like. So it is much more now a belief that the other side is evil and the enemy. And that started very directly and deliberately in Washington with Newt Gingrich back in the late 70s. It worked it took him 16 years from the time he came to Congress, but it worked. It's been accentuated by tribal media, where the business model is an apocalyptic vision because those evil people are going to destroy the country. And it was accelerated when Barack Obama became president, and it's metastasized out to many states and now to the public as a whole. And it's a very, very dangerous phenomenon. And while you're right, although the exit polls on Hispanic votes are probably wrong, if you look at the better and deeper polls done by Latino Decisions, Trump's support was probably down around 18% or 20%. But where we are now is you have this animosity and division, and you've got one party that has divorced itself from the notion that, starting with immigration, we want to broaden our base and broaden our appeal, and instead is moving to narrow it, and it's becoming a white party. And the other party has hemorrhaged white support and is becoming a coalition of minorities. The danger now, and this takes us right back to Lincoln, and of course, race is an ongoing and enduring theme in this society, is that you take partisan tribalism and layer on racial divisions, and you couldn't get more combustible. Yes.
The only problem with that analysis, though.
Tell me who you are.
Oh, Jim Simeone. From Illinois Wesleyan University. We have a delegation of IWU students here. We're so happy to come to the College of Law and to hear you speak. Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Basically, the problem with your analysis, though, is all those rural voters who voted for Obama in 2008. And it seems that they were trying to send a message to the Republicans as well. So it isn't so much a partisan attachment as it is a, we're outsiders and we're going to try whatever we can. So it could be argued.
Sure.
How do you, and then is there hope for the 2018 elections? Because perhaps with the health care, there will be some feedback, and then the people will say, oh, we made a mistake.
Yeah. Both very good points and very good questions. There's little doubt, you know, I haven't talked, because this is more about the Lincoln side, some of the things that I normally reflect on, because partisan tribalism is accompanied by angry populism. And that's another enduring theme of American history that goes back to the founding, obviously takes us through Andrew Jackson, and has emerged at different times. And it has a very positive element to it and a dark side. It's a little bit like Star Wars in that sense. And both are represented now. And we have the surge of populism on both sides. The Occupy Wall Street movement, the strength of Bernie Sanders on the left, the fact that on the Republican side this time, we had 17 candidates, the vast majority of whom were outsiders. And, you know, I wrote a piece in 2015 called Why This Time Might Be Different, suggesting that the candidates left standing on the Republican side were likely to be Trump and Cruz, and that the conventional wisdom, which was they always flirt with the outsider, the Herman Cain type, and then they come back to the establishment candidate. And of course, the establishment candidate of all was Jeb Bush. We'd had Bush 41 and Bush 43. He believed in the family motto, no child left behind, which has gone by the boards in policy and in presidential politics. But it really was the outsider's outsider with Trump and the insider's outsider with Cruz, the guy whose calling card was going on the Senate floor and calling his own lawyer, leader, Mitch McConnell, a liar. And much of that resonated with voters who have been left behind. And the populism is real because the concerns and the outrage are real. When we had the financial collapse, and all the elites in both parties and in the society joined together and said, oh my God, we're at a point where we could end up with a global depression. We've got to act now. And they did TARP, the Troubled Assets Relief Program, or the bailout. And the public reaction was, all right, so what you guys did was to bail out the miscreants who got us into this mess and let them take big bonuses. And what did we get? We lost our homes, or our homes declined in value by 30 or 40%. 63% of Americans in a survey last year said that they could not come up with $500 in cash if there were a family emergency of some sort. It's astonishing, an astonishing figure. And for most of us, whatever asset we have has been in our homes. That's what you've got if you're going to retire or to hand to your kids, to pay for the substantial tuition at many of these schools, or down payment on a house or whatever it might be. And it was more than a body blow to a lot of people. And for a lot of others, they lost their jobs, or if they didn't lose their jobs, in a stagnant economy, their employers knew they were stuck in dead-end jobs, and they could make them work longer hours for less pay. And so we saw this enormous backlash. And the enormous backlash is also in part because we have had astonishing inequality that has grown even more. And the concerns there are real, and they cut across a whole lot of lines. And the sense that everybody in Washington has screwed it up badly has been palpable. And when Donald Trump got out there and said, aimed at the African-American community, what the hell have you got to lose? And we're now in the middle of an experiment to see the answer to that question, but that resonated with a lot of other people. And some of it had a racial overtone, but plenty of it was people who believed they were doing what the social contract suggested they should be doing. They're working, they're putting food on the table, and they're being left behind. And for many of them, they're being left behind because government is providing for others who aren't working as hard as they are. So those are real concerns. And if the two parties don't address those concerns, we're going to have an even bigger problem. And it's those concerns, as much as anything, that got plenty of people who voted for Barack Obama to move to Donald Trump. And at the same time, what we're seeing in the society is not just a division into red states and blue states. Within states, there's a starker division growing between areas around cities of a million or more, in and around them, and cities and areas around them of 250,000 or less, down to communities of 50,000 or so, down to the rural areas, moving like that. And that is not a healthy thing in the society.
One more? That would be the last one.
Okay.
Is it possible that the Freedom Caucus may soften their stance and get health care modified this year, or will that be in the future? And you've heard the talk a couple times of impeachment. Is that a reasonable idea?
So let me talk a little bit about health care, because it also fits into tribal politics. We have a new survey that shows that the Affordable Care Act has an approval rating of 55%. Now, it went up sharply after the election. Barack Obama's no longer president, so it's not Obamacare. And people who opposed it because it was called Obamacare now are finding something that's a little bit different. At the same time, once it's been implemented, and it was very interesting, when Ted Cruz pushed to shut down the government before the Affordable Care Act had been fully implemented, what he said was, we've got to stop this now because once it's there, people are going to like it. And that's what's happened. And it's not only expanded insurance to people, but it's given an enormous number of people a freedom. You can now leave a job and not worry about being stuck. And remember, even after we did the first thing to try and help people in that circumstance, which was COBRA, where if you lost your job, you could keep the insurance for 18 months, except that insurance that was subsidized by an employer to the tune of 70 or 80%, you now had to pay 105% of the premiums at a point where you didn't have any money. So now you've got a safety net, and plus you don't have lifetime limits, and you don't have to worry about bankruptcy and all the other things that we know about, including the pre-existing conditions. And now moving to take it away doesn't work very well. Now, the other part of tribalism with this is, I would recommend to you a piece that I wrote a couple of years ago in The Atlantic called The Real Story of the Birth of Obamacare. when this idea began, it was basically Max Baucus, Democratic senator from Montana, the chairman of the Finance Committee, decided to try to work with his dear friend, Charles Grassley of Iowa, and they did this Gang of Six, and they very deliberately started with the framework that Grassley had used in 1993-94 as the Republican alternative to the Clinton health care plan. It was Grassley and Hatch, the former Senator David Dernberger, the late Senator John Chafee, and it was built around, we don't want a single-payer system, we don't want government health care, we want competition in the private sector, we'll have an exchange with insurers, and we'll set up a marketplace that actually works, where you have to have a certain number of things in the plan, so you can't do a bait and switch with people. And how do we get deal with the problem of pre-existing conditions? You need to broaden the risk pool. So you got to get everybody in the risk pool. How do you do that? The easiest way, the Heritage Foundation said, an individual mandate. So they built this structure, and Mitch McConnell and the Republicans decided that they were all going to oppose it no matter what. And they, after a couple of months, they took McConnell took Grassley and Mike Enzi of Wyoming, two of the Republicans on the Gang of Six, aside and said, "You support any of this, and that's it for you and your careers." So it left them basically where the ideas that they had, they opposed, and they said it's all the worst thing ever done. And back in the summer of 2009, when it was in its gestation period, the then number two leader of the Republicans in the House, Eric Cantor, said, our alternative is weeks away. But they couldn't come up with an alternative that didn't have most of the characteristics of that plan. So they never had a plan.
He didn't say how many.
Yes, well, Every couple of months I've tweeted, we're 300 weeks away, we're 350 weeks, we're up to 400 weeks. And it's obvious that they slap something together after January, and it doesn't work. And it didn't work not just because the Freedom Caucus believed those 60 votes to repeal it and didn't care much about the replacement, they just wanted to repeal it, but also because a wide swath of others are finding that it would be their constituents, and it's the ones you were talking about in rural areas, and it's working class voters who've relied on the Medicaid expansion and on the subsidies that have been provided. So now, and here I'll get back to my discussion of Trump. Can you imagine a Lincoln trying to persuade Congress to pass a piece of policy who didn't know what was in the policy? So when Trump sat down with the dissidents in the Republican Party in Congress to deal with it, and they wanted to talk about what specific provisions they could keep or not keep, he said, and I quote, "I'm not here to discuss the little shit," because he didn't have any idea. "You'll support it because I'm for it, and otherwise we're all going to go down together," and that was it. And now they're trying to come back to it, but frankly they don't have any idea about what to do. And that's part of the problem of being an opposition party for so long. But as you know, when Paul Ryan said, hey, it's the growing pains, we've been in opposition, it's an interesting thing that a leader in Congress who is, that has been in the majority for 6 years would think of himself as an opposition leader, which also tells you something about their mindset in Congress right now. But the Democratic Party had been the party of opposition for 8 years of Bush, and they came in with an agenda. And it was not an agenda shared by everybody. Remember back in 2009, a substantial number of blue dog Democrats, of more conservative members, you had a sizable number of really liberal members who wanted a single-payer system or at minimum a public option. But they all kind of came together deciding that we had to get something done. And that was true of a stimulus package, of Dodd-Frank, of other things. You have a party that has decided to build itself around opposition to the other side, and all of government is awful. And now when you're governing, it's an enormous dilemma. How all of this plays out, I don't know. And impeachment, we don't have a clue where the Russian stuff is leading, what other things might emerge with the president. There is a hopeful note today, which is Steve Bannon being moved away from the National Security Council. The person brought in as number two, KT McFarland, who is not qualified to hold such a position, moving away. General McMaster, who is a really solid guy, appearing now to begin to take some hold over the National Security Council, and the very evil Michael Flynn out of the picture. That's a good sign. But we just don't know, because we haven't been in this position before. We have had presidents who've been failures. We've had presidents who've had issues. I'll be blunt. We've never had a president who's a narcissistic sociopath. And I'm old enough that I can say what I want. And I've run that diagnosis by a large number of professionals, and they go tick the boxes of what is in that particular set of categories, and he fits. And can he adapt? I will just say one final thing. I've been in Washington now for just under 50 years. And I've known a number of presidents. I've had that privilege. And others I've watched very closely. And what's so striking is, no matter what their experience, the day they win the election, they're transformed. That's what I was talking about some with Lincoln. Great example is George Herbert Walker Bush. Who could have more experience? I mean, here's a man who had served in Congress, had been ambassador to the United Nations, to Russia, to China, had been the head of the CIA, had been vice president for 8 years, in the room when the decisions were made. But when he won, all of a sudden, he was going to be the one making the decisions. And it humbled him. And he felt the weight of that on his shoulders. And he felt the weight for all the people who had voted against him as well as the ones who had voted for him. It was the sense that he was responsible now for the fate and well-being and maybe even the lives of hundreds of millions of Americans and of billions around the world. We've never had a president that I've ever noticed who wasn't changed one iota by winning, who wants to change the presidency to fit his own style. And so we are truly in uncharted territory here. And that's why, you know, where I would normally be on the one hand, on the other hand, I don't think you can be on the one hand, on the other hand anymore. This is a threat that we all have to take seriously, and we all have to do our part. You know, it's it may be cliched, but years from now, we'll all have to look back and say, what did we do when there was a significant threat to the fundamentals of a political system that we have all prospered under and that we all cherish? Thank you.
I can't say that I feel better now than I did an hour ago, or
have a nice day,
or comforted. But I do feel better equipped to think about paths forward. And I personally cannot remember in several months being as engaged and stimulated by the penetrating remarks of Norm. So let's give him one more hand. Please accept this very small literal token of our appreciation. And maybe in a couple of years, when this does pan out, maybe Norm will come back and give us a kind of a post-mortem, if you will, on things. Okay? Nice to see you. Thank you all for coming.